Hello, Stephen Dean speaking. And today I want to talk about miracles. And I refer to chapter 1, the very first chapter in the book, A Course in Miracles, the meaning of miracles. And it's the first part, Principles of Miracles. There's 50 principles, but today I just want to speak about a few which I've highlighted because they stand out to me in particular. And the first one is the third one. And miracles occur naturally as expressions of love. The real miracle is the love that inspires them. In this sense, everything that comes from love is a miracle. Well, love is God, and God is love. Love comes from God, and miracles are God. So it's pretty self-explanatory, really, that one. Anything that comes from love is a miracle. Like if you help somebody out who's poorer than you, help somebody out of trouble, for them it's a miracle, isn't it? The eighth one, miracles are healing because they supply a lack. They are performed by those who temporarily have more for those who temporarily have less. That's pretty much what I just said. You know, if you perform a miracle for somebody by giving them money, I mean, like, you might, a beggar in the street, have got nothing, you've got nothing to eat, nothing to drink, then someone comes along and says, "Hey, mate, get yourself a tea and a cake." For him, that's a miracle, is it not? And 10, the use of miracles as spectacles to induce belief is a misunderstanding of their purpose. Yeah, it's like the one about Christ walking on water. I mean, what would he want to do that for, except to demonstrate he can perform miracles? Whether he did or not, I don't know. Then again, he might have walked across the water to rescue somebody. Who knows? But it does say the use of miracles as spectacles to induce belief is a misunderstanding of their purpose. Of course it is. Miracles are of love. You don't use love as a spectacle. Number 16. Miracles are teaching devices for demonstrating that it is as blessed to give as to receive. They simultaneously increase the strength of the giver and supply strength to the receiver. That's because in oneness, what God is, what Jesus is, what we all are, giving and receiving are the same. Because because it's oneness. Everything is one thing. Everything is one. I'm the same as you. In oneness, back there, back home. Like if you give somebody something you feel, you know, you see somebody struggling and you help them, it might cost you a lot of money to do it, but when you see the happiness and see what you've brought about for them, you get all that happiness back, and happiness is worth a lot more than money. 24. Miracles enable you to heal the sick and raise the dead because you made sickness and death yourself and can therefore abolish both. You are a miracle, capable of creating in the likeness of your creator. Everything else is your own nightmare, does not exist. Only the creations of light are real. And miracles enable you to heal the sick and raise the dead. That's an eventual thing. Because when you know that this is a dream, you can do anything in it. And I mean anything. Jesus knew it was a dream, absolutely. And he could do anything. But do you know in the Bible that he did it for people who believed in him? Like the Roman soldier who came out and said, "Come and help my servant." And he said, "I'll come with you." And he said, "You don't need to. You've only got to say, 'Yes, he's healed.' And he'll be healed." And Jesus said, "Never have I seen such faith. Go home, he is healed." And he was. That's the sort of faith that we're talking about here. The sort of miracle we're talking about here. Anybody can perform it once they've awoken and awoken truly. 26. Miracles represent freedom from fear. Atoning means undoing. The undoing of fear is an essential part of the atonement of miracles. It is. The undoing of fear. The getting rid of guilt. Number 39. The miracle dissolves error because the Holy Spirit identifies error as false or unreal. This is the same as saying that by perceiving light, darkness automatically disappears. The miracle dissolves error because the miracle is truth and the illusion is untruth. Nice analogy what you're using there. This is the same as saying that by perceiving light, darkness automatically disappears. So once you see the light of God, all the darkness around you disappears and it dissolves error. Well, error is the illusion. Error is something that isn't as it should be. An illusion is something that isn't as it should be. And the miracle dissolves it, brings truth to it. And the last one, number 45. A miracle is never lost. It may touch people you have not even met and produce undreamed of changes in situations of which you are not even aware. You know, a miracle can be very, very small. They can be very, very small. You could be walking along the street and see somebody walking along looking sad. And you may smile at them, and they may smile back. And that person may have had nothing to smile about all day long, and suddenly you've given something to smile at. You smiled at him, and you induced a smile. It may have cheered them just enough to stop them doing what may have been something a bit drastic. Miracles can be that small. And yet there's no order of size in miracles. In a dream, big miracles are the same as little miracles. Amazing things happen in a dream, and amazing things can happen here. As he speaks about waking the dead, it can happen. He says so it can here. I have to say, in my experience, I haven't come across anybody ever waking the dead. But then again, I'm not absolutely awakened like Jesus. But I'm awakened enough to notice the truth. And it's a really good start. Thank you very much. See ya.